Eric, if you don't have your spouses with you this morning, only your buddy, but I would encourage Paul and Joe to wait till you're back. Okay, we had an incredible talk. Everybody told me it was so incredible what Father Noriega shared with us. And you're not going to find this kind of teaching hardly anywhere else in the world. And we have Father Luis today, who is going to give us an exceptional talk as well. So let us greet Father Luis for us.
Can you hear me, or can you use the microphone better, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for the.
said earlier, we don't experience, and thank you for your talk, by the way, we don't experience a division between our love for our spouse and our love for the Holy Spirit. In the passage you cite in St. Paul regarding remedy for concupiscence, he goes on, of course, and says the married man's interests are divided. He wishes to serve his spouse and he wishes to serve the Lord. But in our daily work, it seems that we married couples do experience a kind of a fragmentation and a division. And things like contemplative prayer or participation in the church's liturgical life become more difficult. Yesterday evening, we wanted to go to Benedictine adoration, but the kids were falling apart. I missed the first half of your talk because I was in the nursery. So how do you, and there must be a way to reconcile this genuine experience of fragmentation with the ideal we propose of a unification. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you. And I think it's part of
I just kind of speaking to that, I have found that part of the struggle that I have had for years and years is wanting to be at Mass or wanting to pray in a way that involved my mental and emotional capabilities fully. And I've come recently to kind of that idea of the gift of the presence. Like, I'm not able to usually do that when I'm at Mass. And sometimes even not during prayer, but it's more of a Christ being there for me and me being there with Christ. And so in a certain sense, it's I've had to kind of let go of the things that I think were more under my control of my, you know, my mental and emotional capabilities in prayer and in worship, and let that fall away to the being with Christ. And I realized that some of what keeps me away from the things I would like to participate in, sometimes it's literally a sick child and you can't eat, but oftentimes it's like this expectation of a focused experience of prayer and liturgy. And when I can let go of that and thrive on the presence, I'm more able to participate in prayer and liturgy than I was as well. And so I think that those things, the presence of Christ, doesn't conflict with my being a mother. Having to focus on something does.
Oh, what happened? I don't know.
Father Luis, thank you for your talk. I appreciated your reference of the etymology of several terms, but as you know, in English, we often, rightly or wrongly, interchange love and charity. So could you give us the underlying Italian or Latin phrase that would correspond to conjugal love as distinct from conjugal charity as you're using them? Is there a difference in the Italian or in Latin for the formulation of the term love? Because in English it can sound like the same.
Amor. Yeah.
In context, we know the difference, as you're showing conjugal charity building upon conjugal love.
Yeah. So.
Amor and caritas would be the two.
I would say. Sorry. It's completely confused what you mean, you know that.
do you have particular suggestions on maybe best practices or best approaches when educating your children with their desires, especially, you know, making them great, purifying them, these kind of things that you mentioned? Are there particular practices that you think are the most effective?
Talking about marriage and virginity as two paths that mutually enlighten one another, do you keep a priority for virginity for the kingdom, or do you find that unhelpful to talk about priority?
We'll take this question right here. Is there a question here? On the riches, and then we'll move on.
Sure. I'm really struck by this idea of education in our desires. There's always an education expanding our desires, making our desires greater. But my experience in life is that I confront more and more my own poverty, my own fragility. inability, and that around me too, that my life seems very small a lot of the time. And I wonder if you can just talk to me about how an expansion of desire actually satisfies the day-to-day experience of limitation. So like in the day-to-day experience of limitation, I feel like the obvious thing is I should just be satisfied with what I have. I should just be satisfied with the imperfection of who I am, satisfied with the imperfection of my life. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you. Yeah,